were one of the more well-to-do families in this area, even before they had acquired this property. And when the family had acquired the property down here in Georgia, they had acquired 320 acres, two full quarter sections, one on top of the other. So their farm was 1/2 mile wide, just a little bit into the woods here, and then stretching 1/2 mile westward, and it was 1 mile long north to south. Having more financial wherewithal when they acquired this property, they had also cleared and brought more of the property into cultivation. Now, I say a little bit about the Dyer family farm because it will factor into the latter part of our story this afternoon. And, of course, it will also fit into the story for tomorrow as well. In fact, this pattern of fields and forests that you see here on the south part of the Dyer farm, and even the pattern of fields and forest on to the north, is pretty close to what it was at the time of the war. The Dyers had also entered into some other business operations, including a tan yard, which stood near the south end of this this field for tanning leather. Some observers will notice some large vats there and even call that industrial operation a niter works. That has been interpreted by some as being a purposeful extraction of material to make potassium nitrate for gunpowder. But you had to do leaching to tan leather as well, so it could just be a larger scale tanning operation, perhaps expanded because of the wartime need for leather in the South. So remember the large open fields here, because when I bring them back into the story later on, we won't see them at that particular moment. We won't see them again until we get back here at the end of this program. But remember how much open ground there is in this area. So we're going to take off now. Come here on to the Brotherton farm, what becomes one of the principal landmarks on the battlefield here along the LaFayette Road. And we're going to pick up the story that many of you all at least learned a part of in the last tour at 12:30. Out to the east of us is the Brock Field, and it is in that area that John Palmer's division of three brigades is going to become engaged. And I'm sure that at least on a couple of the last tours, if you took those, you learned how Palmer's division had been deployed or sent into action in echelon. Hazen's, Kreft's, and Gross brigades each in stair step behind. Did somebody talk about that on the tours?
Yes.
Okay. That allowed, or that is a result of, even by midday, the growing recognition that units' right flanks for the Union Army are being threatened by the arrival of enemy forces on the flank. As Palmer's division becomes engaged out around the Brock Field, additional Union troops are going to march up from the south. Horatio Philip Van Cleve's division, which has spent almost a week in position around Lee and Gordon's Mill, is now sent northward towards the growing sound of battle. They are actually going to loop a little bit further to the west, before coming out into to this area. And Van Cleve is going to deploy his two brigades, Sam Beatty's and Dick's brigades, along the LaFayette Road and send them into the woods on the east side of the LaFayette Road. They will be going in on the right flank of Palmer's division. But by that time, Palmer's right flank has been bent or folded back along the Brotherton Road, parallel with the Brotherton Road and actually facing south. And so, in some ways, this new Union line, as it develops right in this section, is Union troops in the woods just on the south side of the Brotherton Road that you see ahead of you there and facing south, and now additional Union troops deploying along the road here, pushing eastward into the woods and facing east. So the Union line here almost makes a bend or angle like what you see at this intersection here. But of course, that all is all in the woods. There are a couple hundred yards to the east. Sam Beatty's brigade is the left of Van Cleve's division. And they will push into the woods. And Sam Beatty will write in his report, "We remained on the left of the 1st Division at Lean Gordon's Mill until 1 p.m. of the 19th, when I received orders from General Van Cleve to march at the double quick to support of General Palmer, who was heavily engaged. Under the direction of Generals Crittenden and Van Cleve, I formed my brigade in two lines on the right of General Palmer's division, with the 19th Ohio Volunteers and 79th Indiana on the right, and the 9th Kentucky and 17th Kentucky on the left. Advancing about 200 yards, we met and engaged the enemy, driving him steadily for some distance. My front line charged upon and took possession of two rebel batteries. But a heavy flanking movement and fire of the enemy upon my right compelled it to fall back a short distance, when two regiments of the 2nd Brigade, Colonel Dick commanding, formed on our right, and detachments of different regiments of my brigade, chiefly the 79th Indiana, brought off the battery of four guns, which was taken to the rear and saved. The capture of this battery was timely, as it had fired a few rounds of shell and was, when taken, double shot it with canister. This battery that they have overrun is W.W. Carnes's Tennessee battery. What they have found when they pushed into the woods is the left flank of Marcus Wright's brigade of Tennesseans. They had been turning northward to confront Palmer's people facing south from the Brotherton Road. And as they had turned that way, W.W. Carnes had taken his four guns, 2 6-pounder smoothbores and 2 12-pound field howitzers, also smoothbores, and brought the battery up on the left end of Wright's line. They were oriented against a potential threat to the north. They were not looking very far to their left. And that is where Sam Beatty's brigade is going to arrive from. One of Beatty's men says that what attracted us to the battery was not just the noise of its firing, but they had some brand new limber chests. And the inside of the lid of those limber chests was fresh, white, clean lumber. And in the dark woods, they opened those chests of the limbers to draw ammunition, and it flashed like a light in the woods. That gave them a greater idea of where the Union or the Confederate battery was. They close a little closer, and again, the horses of a battery are your easiest targets. They will fire several volleys into Carnes' battery, disable a significant number of horses, capture the four guns, and will begin withdrawing those guns back from the field. But while Wright's brigade is being driven back, a new Confederate unit begins to arrive in this area. And that is the division of Alexander Peter Stewart. Now, some of you all were with us last evening as we walked down to Chickamauga Creek and saw Stewart's division getting across Chickamauga Creek at Thedford's Ford. Stewart's and Preston's division, the other of Buckner's Corps, had that morning wheeled to the left, faced west, and lined up on a ridge overlooking Chickamauga Creek at Hall's Ford and points just to the north. The division was stacked in column of brigades. Each brigade in line of battle, one brigade line of battle behind the other. In Stewart's division, Henry Clayton's Alabamans were in the first line. Johnson Brown's Tennesseans were in the second line. And William B. Bates' Tennessee and Georgia Brigade was in the third line. They were Preston's division was formed in column of brigade as well. The purpose of this being, Bragg intended a massed assault against the Union left flank at Lee and Gordon's Mill. Stewart's division will make a few minor adjustments in its position that morning in that area, but they have heard the sound of battle begin to their right rear. What they didn't know, 3 miles away, but that sound of battle is increasing and roaring towards them. Soon, a staff officer rides up and makes a report or delivers an order to Stewart. And now put yourself in Alexander Peter Stewart's shoes. This is from his report. A subsequent change, made also by order of General Buckner, moved us a space of a brigade front directly to the right. Soon after making this change of position, and as I suppose near noon, Major Pollock B. Lee of General Bragg's staff brought me an order from the commanding general to move to the point where the firing had commenced, which seemed to be a considerable distance to the right and somewhat to the rear of us. That's the order. How are you going to execute it? What kind of direction do you have? Move to a point where the firing had commenced. That's somewhere back there. Based on him facing to the west as I am, which seemed to be a considerable distance to the right and somewhat to the rear of us. There's not much direction. March to the sound of the guns. But exactly where is that? Well, as Stewart was in position there, just a little bit to the west of Thedford's Ford, he had become aware that Braxton Bragg had established his headquarters at Thedford's Ford. Since this order has come straight from the Army commander, not going through his Corps commander Buckner, but straight to him from the Army commander via one of Bragg's staff officers, Pollock B. Lee, Bragg, knowing that Bragg's headquarters was nearby, Stewart decided to seek guidance. Before moving, I went to General Bragg himself, who was nearby, in order to get more specific directions. He informed me that Walker was engaged on the right, was much cut up, the enemy threatening to turn his flank, that General Polk was in command on that wing, and that I must be governed by circumstances. How much does he learn? He has a new division, about 4,500 men, and now they're being told to march towards the sound of the guns. What do you do now if you're Alexander Peter Stewart? Yep. Moving by the right flank in the direction indicated, from half a mile to a mile, they moved out. This is further evidence. This order comes to him just before noon. This is further evidence of how Bragg is still fixated on the desire to attack what he still thinks, still hopes, despite all the evidence to the contrary by that time, that the Union left flank was still down at Lee and Gordon's Mill. He just wants to have this stuff on the right go away so he can launch his main assault. And it is also telling us that his commanders on the right, William Henry Talbot Shot Pouch Walker, Nathan Bedford Forrest, and Leonidas Polk are not doing a good job of keeping Bragg informed about what's really happening up in that area. Now, Stewart's division was formed, as I said, in column of brigades. So I'm going to draft some of you all, okay? So let's see, I need to step through here just a little bit. I think I'll start my draft with you, okay? So I'm gonna make you the 38th Alabama. So get you to stand right there. And sir, thank you for volunteering to be the 36th Alabama. Okay. I'll get you to stand right there. And I'll get you to be the 18th Alabama. And now let's see here. I need five folks across here to be Brown's Brigade. Five, okay, that's good. And let's see, I need four folks across here to be Bates' Brigade. Okay. Here, I tell you what. Let's put you right here in the line. Here we go. So, okay. Now, you all are Stewart's division. You were sent, just to the north of Preston's division, which is similarly formed in a column of three brigades. Preston's left is overlooking the big hairpin bend in the creek at Hall's Ford. You all are just to the north of Preston's division. You're facing off to the west, although I have you facing off slightly to the northwest. You all are facing off to the west. Now, where does Bragg want Stewart to take you all? Somewhere in that direction. So how's he going to get you there? Your skirmishers right here in front, there's a little bit of contact with the enemy. A couple of artillery batteries along this ridge line are firing off at some Federal artillery batteries down in this direction. So, what formation might be used? Well, you could wheel, but is there enough room to do that? Because there are other Confederates up here. You could do an about face and march out of line. How much time is that going to take? And so what the command was for Stewart was to simply right face, and then in this same formation, in column of brigade, because when you were deployed, your front was facing to the west. Now, each one of these brigades, maintaining the intervals between the brigade lines, now they are told to angle off to the north, northeast. And so, essentially, you all would angle off a little bit like this, but maintaining that formation, the intervals between the other brigade lines. So basically, Stewart's division is now going to be marching as three columns of four, spaced properly between them through the woods. You came down off of the back slope of that ridge. You actually walked north or marched north along the eastern side of that low ridge. You're actually sheltered because, as it turns out, about that time, some Federal artillery starts throwing some more shells in that direction. You march behind Bushrod Johnson and Law's division, and you march northward. Now, where Bragg wants you to go is all the way up to the far end of the line, up there where Walker was, up there in the area of Winfrey Field and Jay Steam Sawmill. But can he tell you that? Did he tell you that? No. He said, march to the sound of the guns, be governed by circumstances, go see Leonidas Polk. And as you go marching northward, He says we go from half a mile to a mile. In actuality, they only go about one half mile before they march in or walk into or march in to an area where a disaster is beginning to unfold. Because as they go marching up in this formation, passing beyond the end of Hood's division, they march up into the sector where Benjamin Franklin Cheatham's division has been engaging Palmer's division. And on the left of Cheatham's front line was Marcus Wright's brigade, which had wheeled more towards the north to deal with the Federals who were in the woods south of the Brotherton Road and parallel with it, and exposed their Wright's left flank was exposed. And that is when Sam Beatty fell on the Carnes' battery and Marcus Wright's left. And Marcus Wright's brigade falls apart and goes fleeing to the rear. And just at that moment, Stewart's division began to pass by the eastern side of a large cornfield. Many of you all on the last tour, I'm sure, saw the Brock Field. You hopefully learned that the Brock Field at the time of the Civil War was more than twice the size of the field that you see there today. Basically, take the field that you see there today, double it, add it to the south end of the one that you see there today. Stewart is passing by what would be the southeast corner of that field, flooding out of the woods, across the Brock cornfield, and fleeing from where they have just been driven are the elements of Marcus Wright's brigade. To just conclude Stewart's description of this, moving by the right flank in the direction indicated from half a mile to a mile, we arrived near a cornfield beyond which the heaviest fighting was heard. Messengers were sent in search of General Polk, but without success, and fearing to lose too much time, I determined to advance upon the enemy across the cornfield. Lieutenant W.B. Richmond, aide to General Polk, confirmed me in this design. He came up in search of the general himself and told me that from what he knew of the nature of the ground and the situation of the enemy, a better point at which to attack could not then be found. Now, young Lieutenant W.B. Richmond is a staff officer on Leonidas Polk's staff. When a Civil War general like Leonidas Polk named you to his staff, you've just been named to Polk's staff. You've been announced in general orders to be an aide to General Polk. You have now been colored by some of his authority. And so, I need a Stewart volunteer. Thank you for volunteering. When W.B. Richmond rode up to Lieutenant W.B. Richmond rode up to Major General Alexander Peter Stewart and said, "This is a good place to attack." It might as well have actually been Lieutenant General Leonidas Polk saying, "Attack here." That young Lieutenant W.B. Richmond essentially gave Stewart an order to attack here. Now, the decision to attack is at this time fortuitous for Cheatham's left, because Wright's brigade is being rolled up. And if Sam Beatty and Dick of Van Cleve continue to push eastward, and the right of Palmer starts pressing as well, it might roll more of Cheatham up. But where did Bragg want Stewart to go? All the way to the far end. They've only gone now about halfway, even less than halfway, towards where Bragg intended them to go. But the decision is made with all the fragments of Marcus Wright's brigade coming out of the woods, across the cornfield, and going to the rear to attack here. So now, how is Stewart going to go into the attack? So, thank you, Lieutenant Richmond. You've only got a few hours to live. We'll hear from more of you later on. But General Stewart, and you can stand down from being General Stewart if you'd like. So, thank you for standing in as Stewart. Alexander Peter Stewart now has to make the decision to attack. They're marching up in this direction. What direction, or what is the front of each one of his brigades? It's to their left, face to the west. And so the command is halt. So actually, you all need to face me again. Halt. And the next command is really simple. Front. Because your front is to the west. And now, Stewart is again in column of brigade. And the lead brigade, Henry Clayton's Alabama Brigade. The 18th Alabama has seen combat at Shiloh. The 36th and 38th Alabama are relatively green, inexperienced units. Some of the individual soldiers have previously seen combat in other units, but this is really the first time that these two units have been in battle. And about 1,450 strong, they are ordered forward. And as Clayton's brigade went forward, crossing the cornfield and entering the woods on the other side, you are going to make contact with the Federals in your front. Yes, Beatty and some of Palmer's people as well, particularly for you on this end of the line. I have simplified this just a little bit. Your alignment is just not perfect initially. In fact, you we'll try this just a little bit, okay? You three, Clayton's brigade needs to do a right wheel. too far, so if you step back. That's probably more about the angle you're initially at. As you all start forward in your attack, one of Wright's officers comes up to Clayton and says, if you continue to go forward in the fashion that you are, you're going to expose the right end of your line to a terrible enfilade fire. And so Clayton wants to correct that, and to do that, his decision was to simply have the entire brigade file to the right. So it would be left face. You then started filing to the that direction just a little. That's good. In the end, you wound up essentially doing the same thing, advancing into a place where Federals take the 38th Alabama under a heavy fire. And being in their first battle, the 38th Alabama melts away in large numbers, despite, in addition to the men who were killed and wounded. But after a few minutes of that fight, they will push forward and begin to push Sam Beatty and Dick's brigades back. You on the right end of the brigade will help push some of Palmer's people back as well. But as you fight forward, driving the Federals in your front, you quickly went through what ammunition you had in your cartridge box. And between running short on ammunition and the disorganization that came as a result largely of the brigade being inexperienced, you quickly reach your culminating point. The point at which you have to stop, rest, reorganize, refit, resupply. Now, it's going to stop Clayton's advance, but because Stewart is advancing in column of brigade, what can Stewart immediately do? Advance another brigade, Brown's brigade, and Clayton's men are halted, and there are now plenty of intervals in Clayton's line, and now Brown's brigade is going to pass over Clayton's. So just for, since we don't run over people, actuality, let me get Clayton and Brown to now take one another's place. So. There you go. Brown now comes forward and takes up the fight. And begins driving the same Federals, Dick, Beatty, and some of Palmer's people back. Soon, Brown, the brigade commander, will write in his report. About 11 o'clock, we moved by the right flank 400 or 500 yards in rear of Johnson's division, and soon afterwards 800 yards further, halting immediately in rear the left of Cheatham's division, which was then hotly engaged. His left brigade being numerically overpowered and was repulsed. Was relieved by Brigadier General Clayton immediately in my front. I followed this movement closely, being so near to Clayton's line that many of my command were wounded and a few killed before I could return fire. The front line advanced, but little under the combined fire of the enemy's artillery and small arms until General Clayton reported his ammunition exhausted. About 2 o'clock, in obedience to orders received in person from the Major General commanding Alexander Stewart, I relieved him and encountered the enemy in an unbroken forest. Rendered the more difficult of passage by the dense undergrowth, which for a time, more than 200 yards, extended along my entire line. The difficulties were still further enhanced by the smoke of battle, the burning of the woods, rendering it impossible to distinguish objects 20 paces in advance. My skirmishers encountering the enemy at 100 yards or less, I pushed rapidly upon his lines under a most terrible fire from all arms. There was no position from which my artillery could be served with advantage against the enemy, while two of his batteries immediately in my front and one almost on my right flank filled the air with grape canister shells and solid shot, while volley after volley of musketry in quick succession swept my men by scores at every discharge. For 400 yards, however, my line steadily advanced without faltering at any point until the enemy had been driven beyond the tangled undergrowth and his first line completely routed. A stubborn resistance from the second line, supported by artillery posted upon a slight acclivity in our front and pouring showers of canister upon us for a few minutes, checked our progress. But again, we advanced, driving back the second line up to and beyond the summit of the ridge until my right rested upon and my center and left had passed the crest. Unfortunately, however, at the moment when the rout of the second line was about being made as complete as the disaster to the first, a few minutes previous, a force of the enemy appeared on my right flank and had well nigh turned it, compelling the 18th and 45th Tennessee to retire rapidly and in some confusion under heavy enfilading fire. This necessitated the withdrawal of the center and left, there being no support upon my right for a mile and none in my rear nearer than 600 yards, and which was then not in motion. So Brown will push forward, driving the Federals back in his front, but as he pushed further northwestward, he will actually have his own right flank threatened. And when that threat manifests itself in the 18th and 45th, have to fall back just a little bit, he then must by necessity pull the rest of the brigade back as well. And they will do that. And as they go to the rear, Clayton will then send his third brigade, William Bates' brigade, forward. And now the battle is handed off to Bates' brigade. Now Bates' brigade is going to, it's a split. Part of it is going to go off to the north. Part of it will continue driving northwestward. But they keep the pressure on the Federals in their front, despite the momentary check of Brown's brigade. And now, as afternoon passes, as 3 o'clock comes, Stewart's division begins to push the Federals back in their front out of the woods here along the LaFayette Road, across the LaFayette Road, to the north, northwest, and west. and elements of Stewart's division begin to approach the LaFayette Road. What has Bragg been needing to cut for the last 2 days? The LaFayette Road. Where is he finally starting to get some troops? The LaFayette Road. Except, what is it? It is now the much-attrited brigade of Alexander Peter Stewart and Bates' fragmented brigade leading the drive. Now, during all of this time, Henry Clayton has been having his Alabamans resupplied. They have been reorganized, they have resupplied the ammunition, and now they're going to come forward once again. So Stewart and Clayton, step forward again. You all are now much smaller, so I need all of you to be a littler. But they are going to come forward, and they are going to drive westward. Some of them, some of Bates' brigade even going with them, but they are going to cross the LaFayette Road and into this field. Now, and I was trying to keep us in the shade as much as possible, so I think I will change blobs of shade here. And I also would ask, please no one punch the button on the audio station there, okay? Let me grab my stuff. There is the black line that runs right through there. You can see the black square for the Brotherton farm, marked by today the cabin. You can see the Brotherton Road that runs off to the east. You can see part of Palmer's division, Gross's brigade, being driven back to the north. And now you have Clayton coming forward again, and with part of Bates' brigade, they are going to push across the LaFayette Road. Now, as they pushed the Federals out of the woods on the other side of the LaFayette Road, they actually pushed the Federals back onto a position that had already begun to develop. By this time in the action, by that afternoon, officers were beginning to realize that you did not want to take your artillery with you into the woods. That generally didn't work out real well. And so, you begin to have a few batteries that are not committed by going into the woods. Here in the field is part of the 7th Indiana Battery. And there will also come out of the woods a couple of other batteries or parts of batteries. Because now, as Van Cleve is being driven back, particularly Sam Beatty, their battery, Battery B 26th Light Artillery, commanded by Captain Allison J. Stevens, the nephew and ward of the radical Pennsylvania Congressman Thaddeus Stevens, who, if you remember, if you saw the Lincoln movie, Tommy Lee Jones did such a great job of playing. The commander of the 26th Pennsylvania Battery, or Battery B, 26th Pennsylvania Light Artillery, is Captain Allison Stevens, the nephew and ward of Thaddeus Stevens. That battery, as it is driven out of the woods, is going to lose three of its guns in the woods on the other side of the LaFayette Road, captured by the Confederates. But the remaining three guns form part of a line that is going to rally for a time on this hill. Sam Beatty and Dick's men are going to join this line, and its southern end is going to be anchored by the 92nd Illinois Wilder's Brigade. But they have been detached for the last couple of days, and they were on their way to rejoin Wilder's Brigade when this fight intensified. Their colonel, Smith D. Atkins, will have them dismount. They will tie their horses in the Brotherton Woods, and they will move forward and deploy. Accompanying them is the mountain howitzer detachment of Wilder's Brigade, and the four mountain howitzers go into position and into action as well. But while this stand looks like it has a chance, it's not going to last long. Already, Beatty's and Dick's brigades are broken and shattered a little bit by being driven out of the woods. And another Confederate division, Bushrod Johnson, is now attacking. And Johnson's right is crossing the LaFayette Road to the south of here and threatening the south end of that line. And now, as the renewed attack by Clayton's brigade and part of Bate comes about, they this and head westward. Now, is Bragg finally getting some troops across the road? Yes. But where did he actually need those troops to cross the road? Up on the left end of the Union line. But is this a potential advantage to him? Yes. If it could be exploited. But to exploit this penetration in the line, what is Stewart going to need? Fresh troops, reinforcements. And he has been sending to the rear, requesting them. But they will not come. He cannot find anyone to order fresh troops forward. Later, Stewart will, in his official report, write perhaps one of the most damning statements about the Confederate leadership, particularly on September the 19th. He will say that once he left the presence of the Army commander at near Thedford's Ford, he saw no one on the battlefield higher than division command. What has he just said about his own corps commander? Any other corps commander, Leonidas Polk, who Bragg had said was in command on the right, not anything complimentary. Stewart's men have pushed across the road here, but are they going to get the support they need? As this Union line collapsed, Battery B, 26th Pennsylvania Light Artillery, loses a fourth gun in this action. A couple of the other Union batteries and that had been engaged in the woods on the other side of the road are going to lose guns too. Beatty's men will say after capturing Carnes' battery that they took those four guns to the rear. And this gets to be a real debate amongst both Federals, but even particularly amongst Confederates, about who captured what guns and how many guns were captured. Remember, in the Army of Tennessee, capturing enemy cannon earned you the right to paint cross cannons inverted on your battle flag. And there will be some long and acrimonious debates about who captured which guns and how many. And also, because at least some of Carnes' guns are brought back from the field, it's going to allow Battery B, 26th Pennsylvania Light Artillery, to recoup some of their losses. Leaving here with just two guns, they'll take two of Carnes' guns and refit and put four guns into action on the 20th.
Was it Browns or Bates that crossed up here?
Well, part of Bates is going to get up here. So,
okay.
Because
I knew they got really shot.
Right.
Shot
and that's
badly.
That's what we're going to go deal with right now. Federal force that is being driven back by Stewart's elements as they cross the LaFayette Road is the brigade of William B. Hazen. They had actually been the first of Palmer's brigades engaged out to the east of us in the Brock Field. And having been engaged there and having consumed all of their ammunition, having used up all the ammunition that they had carried out to the east with them in one six-mule wagon, so 15 to 20 boxes of ammunition, 15 to 20,000 rounds, they are now short on ammunition. And the decision is made that part of Turchin's brigade will relieve them out at the Brock Field, and they will pull back and to resupply. When Palmer's division had formed up to go into action, he had left his ordnance train here along the LaFayette Road at the Poe Farm. The buildings of the Poe Farm stood just on the other side of the LaFayette Road where you see those couple of fellows walking. There's a small sign that marks the site there. The division ordnance train, probably about 20 wagons, was parked there along the road and in the area of the Poe Farm. Hazen has come back to resupply his cartridge boxes. He's also reorganized a little bit, and so he is here when the Federals start coming out of the woods. He quickly will move forward in response, and he will write himself later, "I was at this time relieved by General Turchin and ordered by division back to the road to fill my boxes with ammunition and to take charge of some batteries left there without supports. This I had just accomplished when a vigorous attack was made upon that part of our line immediately to the right of the ground fought over by the right echelon of our division. I at once moved my brigade to the right, forming it so as to face the sound of battle, and moved it forward and placed it in position as a support of some troops to General Reynolds, my left resting on the LaFayette and Chattanooga Road, near the field before referred to, where we first formed the line." That's the down at the Brotherton Field. So he actually pushes down, forms his line at an angle to the road. The right being thrown forward, forming an angle of about 45 degrees. The battle neared my position rapidly. At this moment, I met General Van Cleve, whose division the enemy had engaged still further to the right. He told me that his men had given way and that he could no longer control them. The enemy continued to advance steadily, and the line of my front gave way. That's the line marked by the monuments in the field. My own men then advanced to the top of the crest and withstood the shock until they were completely flanked on left, then obliqued well to the right, took up position upon a high elevation of ground, confronting the left flank of that portion of the enemy which had broken our center." So we'll pull back there, pull back to somewhere off in this direction, which he calls high ground. I don't know exactly what, have you ever figured out what he's talking about as high ground?
There is a slight
slight
rise, and a dip in there.
Yeah.
That could be militarily significant.
Yeah.
It's not significant to hikers, runners, joggers.
Yeah, but being shot at and lay down, it's probably high ground. But it's confronting the left portion of the enemy that had broken the center. The advance of the enemy was now steady to the northward, nearly in the direction of the LaFayette-Rossville Road, while another line of the enemy to the east of and parallel to that road was advancing to cross it. I found myself the only general officer upon that part of the field, and to check further advance of the enemy was of utmost importance. I hastily gathered and placed in position, fording down that road, all the artillery then in reach, being the batteries I had been sent to guard, including Standards, Cockerels, Cushions, and Russells, in all about 20 pieces. And with the aid of all the mounted officers and soldiers I could find, succeeded in checking and rallying a sufficient number of straggling infantry to form a fair line in support of the artillery. My brigade could not be brought into position in time, as there was but about 2 minutes to make these dispositions before the blow came, when the simultaneous opening of all the artillery with great checked and put to rout the confronting columns of the enemy. With a line of artillery, about 20 guns formed across the road up there, the north end of the field. As you look far across the field, you can see four guns silhouetted up there. That line continued further as we view it to the right, and also across the road to the left.
I think we should point out that ignore all the guns closer
right
to us pointing this way.
Yeah,
we talk about artillery. There's
they'll come into play tomorrow. So. But at this time, you've got the line of guns at the north end of the field pointing in this direction. And it is a cobbled together line, but it is going to be fortuitous for for the Federals. One of the attacking Confederates in this area, part of Bates' brigade, will write, "There was roar after roar of musketry and artillery, and the rebel yells that could be heard for miles away. After a struggle of about half an hour, that gallant command had to withdraw. Passing back over Bates' line, Brown soon uncovered Bates' front, and at this time everything we had was exhausted except Bates, and the point had not been driven in. We had lain there and had seen two of our best brigades go to pieces. But as soon as our front was clear, I heard someone coming from my left. My regiment was the right of the brigade on horseback, and it was General Bates, riding his old single-footing sorrel. I was standing near Colonel Smith, who commanded the 20th Tennessee, when General Bates rode up and hurriedly to him and said, 'Now, Smith, I want you to sail on those fellows like you were a wildcat.' At once, Colonel Smith gave the command, 'Attention, battalion, fix bayonets, forward, double quick, march.' And the whole brigade moved as one man. In 5 minutes, all the horror of war that a soldier ever witnessed was there. In 15 minutes, we were in possession of every piece of artillery, had broken Palmer's line, and had driven him from the point and cut our way so far in the Federal rear that they began to close in behind us, and we had to fall back. As we did so, we met Brown and Clayton, who had rallied their men. Bates was also badly scattered. We rallied on Clayton and Brown and straightened out our scattered lines." Another one of the 20th Tennessee men will say, "We were sent in by brigades, and two brigades, Clayton's and Brown's, had preceded us. We saw them both repulsed, and moving to the front, were soon under a heavy fire. We pressed steadily forward, unchecked by the murderous discharges of their small howitzers loaded with canister and grape, and drove the first line from their position. Here occurred the prettiest fighting during the whole war. We rushed up on a little hill, and the enemy were just below us, all crowded together in a deep hollow. Our rifles were in prime condition and our ammunition so good that I really enjoyed the fight. The enemy's reserve was soon brought up, and then we had hard work to hold our position. Finally, near dark, we were driven back some distance when night put an end to the conflict." What will stop this part of Bates' brigade here is the fire of those guns across the field. But while part of Bates has reached the southern end of the Poe Field, and while Clayton has now crossed the road and gone into the woods, no help is coming to Stewart in this area. And for the Federals, the action of Joseph Reynolds in initially forming the line in the Brotherton Field, the action of William B. Hazen, both in his role down in the field and then in forming the line here, the stand of that artillery is going to buy enough time for the Federals to react. Fortuitously for the Federals at that time, James Negley's division, which had been down on Chickamauga Creek at Glass's Mill, begins to arrive and will begin to engage Confederates just southwest of the Brotherton Farm. And reacting to this threat, George Thomas has sent the division of John Brannan, which had opened the fight out near Jay's Mill, been relieved, refitted, resupplied with ammunition. Brannan's division is sent south. They're not really needed to seal this this breach, but they are approaching. And the Federals will be able to push Stewart's division back across the LaFayette Road. So the high water mark of Stewart's attack to the north that afternoon is right here at the south end of the Poe Field, when all of a sudden the guns across the field open fire and blow them to a halt. Questions or observations here?
Yes.
Yes.
Whenever a monument is placed, is it depicting a specific battle?
Well, the monuments here are mostly to individual units, regiments and batteries. And those monuments are supposed to be on that unit's line of battle. Now, the big tall monument right there is erected by the state of Georgia to all of their troops in the battle. The few state monuments on the Chickamauga battlefield were given a little more leeway as to where they would be located, but they were still supposed to be on ground, actually occupied by troops of that state. Primarily because on September the 20th, Bates' Georgia Brigade in the big Confederate attack is going to cross this ground. The state of Georgia selected this as the location for the Georgia State Monument. But the monument over there to the 37th Georgia is supposed to be on the regiment's battle line. And so if we were to walk over there and do as they are doing, look at the front of it, it would be as if you were facing the front of the regiment as they faced off in that direction. Now the cast iron tablet, when you stand there and read the cast iron tablet, you're supposed to be able to look up and be looking in the direction that those troops were looking or that battery fired. Now, that's the way they're supposed to be, but they're not all that way anymore. The closer they are to a paved road, the more maintenance has thought that turning them so you can read them from your car while you drive by is a better idea. And so that's why when you were down there in on Brotherton Road in Longstreet's column, and let me get you all to volunteer again for just a moment. So step right up here. You've got tablets on either side of the road, and they're supposed to be positioned like this. So if I was back here, I was reading it, then I would look up and look in the way that those troops were supposed to be facing. But maintenance has decided that it would be easier for somebody in a car to read them if they were turned like this, and this on either side of the road. And so now, you've got this brigade facing that way, and this brigade facing that way. So unfortunately anymore, with the cast iron tablets, you can't always trust their orientation.
I have a quick question about positioning of names on monuments. I noticed on Dyer Road, where the Thrasher House marker is, immediately next to it is the monument of the headquarters of General Longstreet. And visitors were on Sunday when the timeline was, said, well, that's odd to have a marker like that for a house. And then I remember from before, or my books, that it's the marker of General Longstreet, but the name is in the back. It's not visible to the side, right. The same as with General Rosecrans on the
right. So on those headquarters markers, theoretically,
you must go around.
You would have to go around. Because theoretically, if you were standing there where you could read the tablet, it would be as if you were facing the general when he was looking towards the enemy.
I see.
So that doesn't always perfectly follow suit, but that is the case with the Rosecrans headquarters one and the James Longstreet one and several of the others that I run my head through right now.
Jim.
Yes.
An additional question about the headquarters marker. I noticed that the Bragg one over here off of wherever.
Brotherton Road.
Yeah. It seems like it has a double pedestal to it, making it higher. Is there some significance to that?
Now, I don't know exactly why so much of the cut limestone base is exposed on that one as opposed to others. So,
they thought so much of them to go and make it bigger?
Maybe. So. Okay, let's see here. We need to head back, so we're going to go down the road and recross.